Welcome, we'll talk about NCERT class 8, the history second chapter that talks from trade to territory. Now, as the title denotes, this talks about Britishers adventing into India, and when they first came into India, their sole purpose was trade. They had nothing to do with the expansion of territory. Now, how all this is started and how they moved from trade to territory would be discussed in this class. Now, I want you to take this class as more of a story so that it becomes more interesting and you have more it would become more joyous to learn this chapter. So it all started with the Mughal Emperor, and the last most powerful Mughal Emperor was Aurangzeb. After that, there was no one powerful Mughal Emperor that came to power, and the power of the Mughals slowly started to dissolve. It was during that time that company was gaining strength in India. The company first came into India with a charter passed by Queen Elizabeth I, and that charter exclusively had the rights for East India Company into India. Under that right, it was specifically mentioned that no other trading company from Britain would trade into India, and East India Company has the exclusive rights for it, but that was meant only for Britain. You had people coming in from other countries. So Vasco da Gama, during that time, who was a Portuguese sailor, discovered India. You had traders from Dutch, you had traders from France coming into India, and all of these were competing for trade. The only objective of trade was get the things at lesser price from India and the other countries across the world and sell it back into Europe at a higher price and earn the profit. So buying it at lower price and selling it at higher price was the sole objective. Now, what were the things that were traded? So cotton, silk, all spices, mainly pepper, cardamom, you had all these spices that were traded during that time. Now, since there were different people from different countries who were working into India during that time, there was internal mutiny that was created. So they used to block the routes, they used to harm each other's ships and block the path or create a kind of unhealthy rival competition. Out of all these, it was the British company, that's the East India Company, that survived the best in India. All others, the Portuguese, the Dutch, the French colonies, were confined to small pockets into India. Now, when the revolt of 1857 took place, it was Bahadur Shah Zafar who revolted against the Britishers, and he was finally arrested by Captain Hudson. So that was the thing that happened after the East India Company entered into. Now, let's understand what happened and how the factories got established. So you have the map of India. The first factory was established in the area of Bengal on Hooghly River. Now, this first factory was established here. This factory required merchants and traders. So the Britishers brought in everyone close to the factory, and slowly and gradually they started guarding whole of the factory premises, and they built up a strong fort around. Now, this Aurangzeb during this time issued a farman, and under that farman, which is a royal order, they were given the right to trade, and that trade could be duty free, but they had to pay the taxes to the Bengal government. However, the Britishers, the East India Company, was not paying the taxes to the Bengal government. As a result, this Bengal government suffered huge revenue loss. During that time, the rulers of Bengal were very, very strong. The Nawabs of Bengal were very, very strong. It started with Murshid Quli Khan, followed by Ali Wardi Khan, and the last major Nawab here was Sirajuddaula. And it was Sirajuddaula during whose time you had a strong mutiny with the Britishers, and the Battle of Plassey took place. Now, during that time, Madras was also a developed port in India, and this was under the Robert Clive. So Clive sent in naval ships to Bengal. So he sent in naval fleet to Bengal to have a revolt with Sirajuddaula. He slowly realized that Sirajuddaula was really powerful and they should adopt a kind of strategy to bring him down. So they asked one of his members who was Mir Jafar to join with the British army, and they said to Mir Jafar that if we won the battle, you would be crowned as the Nawab of Bengal. Mir Jafar was in a way forward, he was looking to be the Nawab of Bengal. So when finally the Battle of Plassey took place, now Plassey is the name which is derived from the word Palash, which is a flower from which the holy colors are made. Now during that time, what Mir Jafar did was, Siraj-ud-Daulah used to send armies to fight with the Britishers, but Mir Jafar would not even fight, and slowly and gradually Siraj-ud-Daulah left, was defeated, and he was assassinated. Mir Jafar became the Nawab of Bengal, but this Mir Jafar was a puppet ruler because he was working on the hands of Britishers. Since he was working in the hands of Britishers, what happened was, he had to follow each and every order. Now once he became the Nawab, he felt that why should I follow each and every order that has been given to me? So he protested. When he protested, he was thrown out, and Mir Kazim was brought to throne. Mir Kazim was another puppet ruler. Slowly he also felt that I should revolt, and Mir Kazim fought the Battle of Buxar. Now this Battle of Buxar was after the Battle of Plassey, first of all. Under this Battle of Buxar, Mir Kazim was defeated, and Britishers reinstated Mir Jafar back to throne. After the death of Mir Jafar, Robert Clive announced that Britishers would be their own Nawabs. They would not have any other Nawab rulers from India. So it was at this point that they decided that we should not only trade, but we should hold the territory. Now what was the benefit? The benefit in the very simple terms was, they could hold the Diwan, or the Diwani of Bengal. Now once they have the Diwani of Bengal, all the revenue comes in the hands of British. Now since all the revenue is in the hands of Britishers, they don't have to look back to Britain to ask for money to maintain their forts, to maintain their troops, to maintain their factories, and to give salaries to the employees or the merchants or the traders. So the thing was, they got control over the Diwani or the revenue of the Bengal, and finally they created a scenario where they did not require a penny from Britain. So they became self-sufficient, I would say, in India. Till now they were asking for money from Britain. So this Robert Clive, who came from Madras to Bengal, who initially came at an age of 18 years, when he left India, he had amassed a wealth of 4 lakh pound. Now, when British interrogated and cross-examined it, he was found culprit and he committed suicide. But it was not just Robert Clive. Many such Britishers came to India with the idea of looting India, collecting the wealth, amassing the wealth, and moving back to their own country. So they called themselves Naboobs, and this Naboobs means an angelicized version of the Indian Nawab. So they called themselves the Nawab in Britain under the name of Naboob. Now how does the company's expansion policy work? The company was very clear about its policy that we will not do any military attack, all would be through diplomatic methods and through the political and economic methods that we will conquer whole of the India. So they started with a policy of subsidiary alliance. This is very, very important. Under this subsidiary alliance, they said that the Indians cannot maintain an independent army. Any Indian state will not be allowed to maintain an independent army. They were to be protected by the army given by the company, and they will have to pay to the company for the same. So all the force that company is keeping in their territory, they would have to pay for that, and if they fail to pay, they will have to give the penalty, and that penalty would be the whole territory. So if they were at fault at half a level, they would acquire half of the territory. So Warren Hastings, what he did was, he acquired half of the territory of Nawab, of Awadh, and he also acquired territories of Hyderabad during that time. So that was a policy of expansion that they followed through subsidiary alliance. However, this was not accepted by some of the brave rulers like Tipu Sultan. Tipu Sultan was known as the Tiger of Mysore. Now first understand why he was known as the Tiger of Mysore. He was walking in one of the jungles in Mysore with his French friend, and suddenly a tiger came up. He did not, his dragon fell off, and he fought with the tiger alone without any arms and ammunition and won. And therefore, even the flags of Mysore have tiger as one of the symbols. Now, this Tipu Sultan, who was the son of Hyder Ali, had suggested an idea that he stopped any kind of trade with Britishers. So, that region was known for sandalwoods. He stopped the trade of sandalwood, pepper and cardamom. So those were the main things that were traded during that time. So Tipu Sultan had good relations with French. As a result, he modernized his army. He fought four wars with Britishers, and it was only in the last war that Tipu Sultan was defeated and his capital Srirangapatnam was annexed. Now, in the last war, why was Tipu Sultan defeated? The only reason was that Britishers joined the forces of Marathas and the Nawab of Hyderabad, and there was a kind of combined attack on Tipu Sultan, and which could not be beared up, and therefore state of Mysore finally lost and was annexed by Britishers. Tipu Sultan was forced to sign a treaty. Under that treaty, both of the two sons of Tipu Sultan were taken as hostage to Britain. Again, Tipu Sultan's interesting story is the toy tiger. He used to maintain a toy tiger where there was a tiger sitting on a European, and every time the tiger roared, the European who was lying below shrieked, and that was the kind of bravery he used to depict in his toys even. And this toy was annexed during that time and is preserved now today in the Victoria Museums in London. So it was taken away in 1799. Similarly, as they were working around in the South India, they had annexed Bengal. They moved with the state of Mysore. Now the next was Marathas. Marathas, they had three wars that were fought. Four with Mysore, three with Marathas. The first was the Anglo-Maratha War, and you had the Treaty of Salbai that was released. The second was, under the second war, with the Anglo-Maratha War, the Britishers annexed Odisha and north of Yamuna, that's the part of Agra and Delhi. And finally, in the third Anglo-Maratha War, Marathas were totally crushed out. 1761 was the period where there had been the third battle of Panipat. This third battle of Panipat was fought in Haryana. Now remember, this is a battle of Panipat fought in Haryana, but this was between the Marathas and the Britishers. Both of them had nothing to do with Haryana, but the place where the battle was fought was in Haryana, that is Panipat. And during this battle, Britishers won. Now Marathas were named under different dynasties. So there were Sindhias, Holkers, Gayakwad, Bhosle. All of these were working under Peshwa, who was the principal minister of the Marathas. However, Lord Hastings during that time felt that we have annexed a lot of South India. However, North is still at risk because Russia is gaining power, and if Russia is gaining power, Russia could annex the North of India. We have already acquired a lot of South. So their idea was to shift towards the North and protect the attacks from Afghanistan and the northern territories of Russia. So they tried to establish paramountcy, which was the supreme power or the supreme authority, and that idea came by Lord Hastings. However, there were some exceptions. The Kittur area of Karnataka was under Rani Chennamma, and Rani Chennamma was a very brave leader, and she was strongly anti-British in sentiments. So she had a strong resistance movement. She was arrested in 1824, but still her chaukidar Rayanna kept on fighting, and it was till 1830 that they kept on fighting against the Britishers. But slowly it was annexed and whole of the South India was under British rule. Moving towards the north, they annexed Sindh, then they annexed Punjab after the death of Ranjit Singh. And now there were some territories that were remaining. So what was the next interesting thing was Lord Dalhousie. Lord Dalhousie, when he became the Governor General, he passed a new law that was known as the Doctrine of Labs. Now under this Doctrine of Labs, it was a simple concept that if the throne does not have a male successor, that throne would be annexed by the Britishers. So only if there is a male in hierarchy who can come to the throne, he would be ruled, he would be ruling the state, otherwise that state would come under the British control. So by that principle simply, they annexed Satara, Sambalpur, Udaipur, Jhansi and Nagpur. Now since they annexed so many states, much of the central and north India was under British control again. Avadh was one of the states that was fighting till the end, and this Avadh was finally annexed in 1856, stating that there was lot of misgovernment that was going on in Avadh, and this Avadh needs to be part of the British Empire. And finally, Britishers annexed Avadh. However, when the 1857 revolt took place, it was Avadh that joined the forces. So as you can see, Britishers came up and established only few trading ports and factories in Calcutta and the regions of Madras. Slowly they grew up in South India and parts of Central India. And slowly, if you can see here, nearly 63% of the area and 78% of the population was under British control. Now there were certain administrative changes and scientific reforms that started during this period. Warren Hastings was one of the major rulers, governor generals I would say. So Warren Hastings, he introduced that Britishers worked under the system of presidency. Each presidency was under the governor. Now he was the first governor general to introduce the idea of reforms in justice. So he brought up two kinds of court, the civil court and the criminal court. Criminal court was known as Faujdari Adalat under a Qazi, and civil court was known as Diwani Adalat under a Mufti. However, Warren Hastings was impeached for 7 years and he was sent back to England. Later on, Brooke accused that he was responsible for all the misgovernment that was taking place in the state of Bengal. Now, different people from different religion came up with different laws. So Hindu Pandits, the Brahmin Pandits started with the Hindu law. They gave up the Hindu law and there were 11 Pandits who compiled the Hindu law. N.B. Halhet translated this into English. Then Muslims came together and they gave a code of conduct, which was a code of conduct for the Muslim law, and Muslim law was given to Europeans. And finally, you had the Regulating Act of 1773, very, very important, where the new Supreme Court was established and a court of appeal under the name of Sadar Nizamat Adalat was established in Calcutta. Indian districts had a collector in each district, and the idea of this collector, or the work of this collector, was to collect the revenue. As a result, the office where he was sitting up was known as the Office of Collectorate, which still goes on today. So these were the things that the Britishers were doing in the development or the administration or the justice field that time. Now when it comes to the army, they were mainly maintaining the infantry, those who could walk. So they were having swords, they were good at archery, tirandazi. Then they were cavalries who could run on horseback. However, when the attacks from Burma and Afghanistan started, those people who were attacking from Burma and Afghanistan used to have muskets and matchlocks, which were guns. So these cavalries could not stand in front of the gunned people, and they had to develop guns during that time. Similarly, there was technology that was evolving. So steam technology entered during 19th century. Till that time, the distance from Britain to India was covered in 6 to 8 months, and with the launch of this steam engine and steam technology, this distance was reduced to only 3 weeks. So there was lots and lots of development that was taking place. However, there were revolts taking place in India, but similar movements were going across the world. So during that time, you had Dutch that had established in the 17th century in Africa, and they used to take the people of Africa as slaves for work in their own home nation. And finally, these people were captured and sold into the slave markets. This slavery was stopped or ended in 1834, where nearly 36,000 privately owned slaves were there in Cape in Africa. So all these were the world movements that were going on. With this, we complete the second chapter on history. The further chapters are further more interesting, which talks about the Indian National Movement. We'd be talking about those chapters in the upcoming lectures. So do subscribe to our channel. If you have any doubts, any suggestions, leave those as comment below the video. We'll be more than happy to answer those. Have a good day ahead.